You know, throughout history, men have made some pretty important statements. Give me liberty or give me death. I regret that I have but one life to give for my country. And the most famous, nobody touches my stuff. See, men are territorial by nature. And of all the things in the natural world that a man will fight to hang on to, nothing is more sacred than the TV remote. When we're watching TV, we hold on to this thing like a fat kid with a corn dog. But every now and then, you need to have both hands free. Like when you want to pick up your beverage and the snack bowl at the same time. And in that split second, your wife steals the remote, and the next thing you know, you're watching Dr. Phil. Well, this is a good time to remember the second law of marital dynamics. She won't steal what she can't use. See, this remote doesn't have any batteries in it at all. They're duct taped to my wrist here. And you see these wires? They're connected to the rings that I have on my fingers, which just happen to line up with the contacts on the back of the remote. Happy flipping. Oh, never could remember which finger the wedding ring goes on. A little bit late, we were trying to launch my new boat. Boy, she's a beauty. Classic wooden hull. Got a little rot in her, but she was only 30 bucks, including the air fresheners. The problem is the darn boat ramp. We got so many sunken boats and tow vehicles and snowmobiles in there, you have to actually pry your trailer through the shipwrecks.
This is not funny.
Harold, I told you to stay in the boat.
It sank to the bottom. You said that wouldn't happen again.
It's the darn boat ramp, Harold. There's so much sunken crap in there. That's the problem.
Well, call the people who left all their stuff in there to get them to haul it out.
Well, people can't be bothered doing that.
How do you know?
Because it's my stuff and I can't be bothered doing it. See, all we gotta do is build a new boat ramp over the old boat ramp.
Oh. What do you know about building boat ramps?
Oh, Harold, it's pretty darn simple. It's like gravity. I mean, it's like being a plumber. All you gotta remember is water goes downhill and payday's Friday.
No, it's not like plumbing, it's engineering. Please, do me a favor, please. Just build a scale model of the boat ramp first.
Oh, Harold.
Yes, because if it works in miniature, it will work in normal size.
All right, okay. But I want you to think about the plan that I come up with and see if it makes sense in your mind.
I will be happy to do that.
Good. Because if it works in miniature, it'll work in normal size.
It's time for the Possum Lodge Word Game! Woo-hoo-hoo! Yes, sir, and today's prize is a coupon to have your picture taken with Bobo, the world's largest rabbit. He stands 4 foot tall at the shoulder, and each ear weighs 50 pounds. Oh, warning, do not shout around Bobo or dress up as a carrot. Okay, Red, cover your ears. You got 30 seconds to get Winston to say this word. Intimate.
Yeah, all right.
And go!
Okay, Winston, if you know somebody and you can reveal your personal secrets to them and they won't tell anybody, what kind of friend is that?
An imaginary one.
Okay, no. This is something people do behind closed doors.
Hide?
Remember when Harold got mad because we all read his diary? That's because the things that were written in there were...
hilarious!
Time's almost up, Red.
Yeah, no. Okay, Winston, you know, I never talk about Bernice and I and the things that we do, you know, like later on in the evening at night, okay? Because it's...
boring.
No, I'm talking about what Bernice and I do in the bedroom.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Renovations.
You have no idea what goes on in the bedroom, Winston?
Well, I doubt there's much going on between you and Bernice, if that's what you're trying to intimate.
Yeah, that's it.
through with the expert portion of the show. This is the part of the program where we examine those three little words that men find so hard to say.
I don't know!
It's because it's true. Okay. Here's today's letter. It goes as follows. Dear expert.
La, la, la.
I've been happily married for 23 years, but lately an attractive woman at my office has been making passes at me. How can I tell her I'm not interested without hurting her feelings? Has this ever happened to you?
Dalton?
I'm still stuck on the happily married part.
Oh, brother, you guys.
It's not like we haven't had beautiful young women pursuing us, Harold.
Yeah, that's right. We're just trying to remember what we did in each individual circumstance.
Maybe you woke up?
Any chance you'll ever wake up, Harold?
You know, I remember now. Once I was with Pam Stubbs in Port Asbestos, you know, and there we were, all alone in her office. She reaches over and she closes the door. She starts asking me a whole bunch of personal questions. She reaches over. She starts touching my knee.
She's an arthritis specialist, though.
Yeah, okay, well, I suppose all sorts of women are interested in you.
Well, as a matter of fact, I do. Yes, I do. In fact, I do. The other day, I overheard old man Sedgwick's daughter tell Harold that she really likes my furry beard.
She didn't say she liked your furry beard.
What?
No, she said she thought you were very weird. Well, I can see, obviously, we need someone here with some, you know, personal experience, which is me, la, la, la.
This should be good, huh?
Yeah.
Well, my advice to this viewer is that you simply take the person aside in private and say, although someone as wonderful as them is very tempting, it simply cannot be.
Actually, that's not bad.
Yeah, but what if it doesn't work?
Well, then you gotta be firmer. Yeah, you just say, you know, okay, well, I'm not interested, and I never could be, you know, and you gotta stop hanging out in front of my house. You gotta stop telling your friends that you're going out with me, and if you don't, I'm gonna call the police on you, Harold Green.
You know, you try your best to save the environment, switch to an electric lawnmower, where does it get you? Back to the hardware store for another 100 feet of extension cord. Don't worry, as usual, I got a better idea. First thing we have to do is take down this chain link fence. I'm sure some of you have seen streetcars, and if you're not familiar with streetcars, I'm sure you've driven bumper cars. And if you're not familiar with bumper cars, you're probably not watching this show. But we're gonna use that same technology to make our modified electric lawnmower here. So you got two wires coming off the electric motor. I attach one of them to the frame of the mower, and the other one attached to this fence post here. Now, some of you may have already noticed that I've replaced the standard issue rubber lawnmower tires with these clothesline pulleys, because they're metal and they conduct electricity. Not that you need to be metal to conduct electricity, as old man Sedgwick found out when he relieved himself onto a power transformer. Okay. The only other modification we need here is to make a softer contact point for my fence post. Done. Okay, so instead of hooking the lawnmower up direct with an extension cord, which I then run over for the third time this month, only to find out that the warranty covers their mistakes, not mine, I got a little different way of hooking up the electricity. Took one wire, attached it to this spike I got in the ground, see, and that connects to the metal wheels on the lawnmower. And then the other wire I attached to this electric grid that I made out of our chain link fence. And once the leaf rake connects with that, see, that closes the circuit, makes the lawnmower go. Isn't that a lot safer than lugging around a dangerous extension cord? So remember, if the women don't find you handsome, they should at least find you handy. And now, if you'll excuse me, I gotta go save the environment. I want to talk to you older guys about your good looks, or more specifically, where they went. Now, you may think that your handsome, youthful body is behind you, but the people standing back there wouldn't necessarily agree with you. You look bad, but here's the good news. You look way better than you're gonna look. Unless, of course, you start eating right and exercising. Yeah. Okay, sure, I suppose you could start wearing makeup and a girdle and have some cosmetic surgery, but you know what? That's for guys who bake pies and make their own curtains. I got a better idea. As your looks start slipping, so should your standards. You don't have to look good. You just have to look good enough. Don't get a facelift, just sit near a basset hound. You'll look fine. Don't make any effort at all. See, apathy is the key to a youthful appearance. I mean, teenagers don't care about anything. See how young they look? And don't worry about people saying you've let yourself go. They've already been saying that about you for about 10 years. Remember, I'm pulling for you. We're all in this together.
I guess I'm just lucky. Well, some people go through their entire lives without ever really knowing their true purpose. But for me, ever since I was a young boy, I've known that I was put on this earth to suck sewage. Oh, sure, yeah. Yeah, the kids used to tease me a bit. They'd say, Winston likes to suck sewage, or there goes Winston, the sewage sucker. Or I also remember them saying, hey, Winston, why don't you go suck some sewage? You know, that type of thing. But where are those kids now? Well, okay, actually, a lot of them have done pretty well for themselves, but that's not the point, right? Yeah, I think when folks call me, they know they're getting a real person. Yeah, sure, you could call one of those big, faceless, multinational sewage-sucking companies, but, you know, it's not always about who has the biggest truck, right? It's about people. People with septic tanks. If you're having a problem, call me, we'll talk. I'm here to lighten your load.
Winston Rothschild and you, one of life's special relationships.
I don't know what it is about a middle-aged guy and the sound of running water. If I was deaf, I would have had this done an hour ago.
Uncle Red, here's the board that you wanted.
Oh, no, it's not a board, Harold. That's my model boat ramp. See, I'm doing what you said, Harold. I build the whole thing in miniature, see? Because arguing is just a waste of time and energy.
Now that sounds like a mature man.
No, it sounds like a married man, Harold. You see this tub here? That represents Possum Lake.
Well, that can't be. This is water.
Oh, and you see all this scrap here? This represents the various boats and towing vehicles that have come to an untimely demise during the launching process.
Now, is this to scale?
It's a little low, but I ran out of broken toys. Okay. And now, of course, what we have here is we got the tow vehicle, and we got the boat that we're actually trying to launch.
Oh, look out! Yeah. That is so cute!
Yeah. I'll be sure to tell Ken and Barbie that you liked it. Now we just put our boat ramp into place just like that, see?
Ah.
Yeah. Yeah.
How do you get onto it?
Oh, well, no, okay, so you drag her back till it's past the halfway point, see, and then she slips down this way, see? Then you take your unit, and as you do, it's as simple as this. You back her up, and then once you get past the halfway point, see, she's like, oh. We had a problem. We had kind of a flash flood. We knew the water was going to come up at Possum Lake because Moose Thompson had done a cannonball up near Port Asbestos. And it was coming up over there, and we knew we had to do something and do it quick. And we had this boat out the back, and she wasn't in the best shape, and we just thought if we could get her out of the way, we'd just move her up because she doesn't float real good. And unfortunately, it's pretty heavy and kind of rotted into the ground. So we thought, you know, rather than try and move the boat, what we would do is we'd like build a kind of a dike, a wall around it. Just needed a couple of shovels. And okay, this is the downside of never cleaning out your van, but I'm not saying you have to clean out your van. I'm just saying that if you're not going to clean out your van and you're trying to get a shovel out of her, you got to be pretty creative. So now the idea is we're going to dig up some sand and we're going to make some sandbags. So I'm telling Dalton and Walter to go and get us some bags, any kind of bags you can get, so Dalton sees a garbage can there and figures we'll just use those garbage bags. And we got a fair bunch of sand there, and then Walter shows up, and I was impressed that he had emptied the garbage bags first. I was asking, where did you empty them exactly? And then I definitely got to clean out that van one day soon. So we started making the sandbags, and they did kind of like a bucket brigade unit with it there. So, I mean, they're heavy. They are heavy, and you just move from one guy down to the next and so on. And the water was starting to come up, but we're getting there, and just he starts the wall, and watch out for the shovel there, Dalton. Oh, no. Oh, boy. Okay. Nope, we're good. So we just got that out of there, and well, I didn't realize that it actually cut the bag, and this one wasn't quite as heavy as the other one. I don't know quite what you're going to do with that, Dalton. Anyway, time went by, and we eventually got all the bags made up. And Dalton's wondering how high the water is at this point, because he was coming up pretty good. So Walter, get a boost up there, reach over to the side, and see how high the water is, and you can actually feel it. Oh, the water's pretty close. Oh, my gosh, look out. Oh, it's your wake-up call. And put that back where it belongs. There we go. And we got the whole, look at the water, it's right up there. Suddenly, I remember the possum van. Oh my gosh, it's caught up. So Walter says he'll go get it. He's going to put the life ring on, and he's going to use the rope from the boat to anchor himself so he can control the flood and so on. Because we're pretty much at the height over there, and he was just starting to come down a little bit. But what he didn't realize is there's a fair bit of current going there, and it was starting to pull on him real hard. And he actually ended up pulling the boat up and over the wall of the dike. And by then, of course, the water had run away. And okay, there's Walter. And okay, everything's good. It looks to me like it. Well, look at this. I did get the possum van cleaned up. You know, one of the important differences between Canada and the States is that up here, we get a $2.40 refund for every empty case of beer bottles. Oh, sure, up here, a case of beer costs $20 more, but hey, that only matters if you're buying. See, but the problem is that our American friends end up with all these empty cases of beer, and they're looking for suggestions on what to do with them. Well, here's a natural. An outdoor urinal. Kind of completes the circle, doesn't it? And in keeping with the beer case motif, I cut up an old refrigerator box and made flaps for the top of the unit so that it closes up just like the real thing. And the beauty of this design, in the good weather, you can just push up on the roof, make yourself a skylight. Mind you, you know, it's not all that dark in here, because I added a few beer bottle windows. They let the light in, but they still maintain your privacy. And it's your choice on those. You can go with the standard brown long necks. Or for a little taste of Mexico, try the clear bottles. And if you really want to impress the neighbors, go with the green imports. Now, the toilet itself is an empty keg. Just pry the lid up and you're in business. Oh, sure, it's a little cramped, but like I say, this is a men's urinal, standing room only. My mother always said it's not good for your health to sit in a draft. Well, that was a good idea to build the model. You know, Harold was right. Boy, that's hard to say. But we got her all figured out. We've actually got the real thing out for a trial run there. Mike's going to actually be our test pilot.
Okay, Mr. Green, I'm all set to drive the possum van. You got the keys?
No, I think they're in it.
Not a problem.
All right. But Mike, what if they're not in it?
Not a problem. Hey, Uncle Rick.
Yeah, Harold, we've had kind of a breakthrough here, see? We don't actually have to get the possum van over the scrap. We just got to get the boat to go over the scrap, eh?
Really?
Yeah. So what we did was we moved the marina outhouse over, because nobody uses it anyway unless there are women there. And then that becomes the fulcrum for our boat ramp, see?
Right.
Okay. But where we were going wrong was the teeter-totter thing didn't have enough oomph to her, eh? Wow. So I duct taped a couple of honky sticks together to hold the ramp up, eh? Right. Then I firmed up the hitch on the possum van. So now when the possum van comes up, it hits the hockey sticks and... Ah! All right, Harold. Let's see how it works in the normal world, huh?
Yeah, but you don't live in the normal world.
Okay, Mike, let her go. Keep your eye on the lake. Watch for the splash. you see, with a model, you don't have to worry about wind.
Period.
All right, you go ahead. I'll be right down, Harold. Okay, my wife is watching. I'll be coming straight home after the meeting. And as Hugh Hefner once said, you eventually get too old to be fooling around with models. The rest of you, thanks for watching. Me, myself, and Harold, and the whole gang. Keep your stick on the ice. All right, bow your heads for the man's prayer.
I'm a man, but I can change if I have to. I guess.
All right, man in need, a show of hands. Anybody's willing to help clean up the crap out of the boat ramp? Okay, I'll sweeten the deal. You get to keep whatever you haul out of there.